gambling. Forbidden in their faith, yet so alluring. The MIT students, brilliant minds seeking a challenge, saw it as a puzzle to solve. Could they use their intellect to beat the odds, to conquer the house? The idea was audacious, bordering on reckless. But the potential reward, both financially and intellectually, was too tempting to resist. These weren't hardened gamblers chasing a quick buck. They were mathematicians, statisticians, masters of logic, ready to take on a system designed to be unbeatable. Their weapon of choice? Not luck, but knowledge. Their ammunition? A method known as card counting. The team was an eclectic mix of personalities, each bringing their own unique skill set to the table. They were not just students, they were innovators, thinkers, and dreamers. Each member had a distinct role, and together they formed a formidable unit. There was the quiet genius, the one who could see patterns where others saw chaos, the charismatic leader who inspired confidence and unity among the group, the meticulous planner who left no detail unchecked, ensuring every move was calculated and precise. They were drawn together by a shared love of numbers, a thirst for intellectual stimulation, and the audacity to challenge the status quo. Their bond was forged in the fires of intellectual curiosity and a mutual desire to push boundaries. Meetings were held in dorm rooms, strategies scribbled on whiteboards amidst half-eaten pizzas and empty soda cans. These sessions were intense, filled with debates, calculations, and the occasional burst of laughter. The cluttered rooms were a testament to their dedication and relentless pursuit of perfection. The air crackled with excitement, with the thrill of the unknown. Every shuffle of the cards, every roll of the dice, was a step into uncharted territory. The anticipation was palpable, and the camaraderie among the team members was unbreakable. They knew the risks, the potential consequences if caught. The tension was ever present, a constant reminder of the high stakes involved. Yet, it was this very tension that fueled their determination and sharpened their focus. But the allure of outsmarting the system, of proving their mettle, was too strong to ignore. Each victory, each successful maneuver, was a testament to their brilliance and teamwork. They were not just playing a game, they were redefining the rules and proving that with intellect and strategy, anything was possible. Card counting. It sounds complicated, shrouded in an air of mystique. But at its core, it's simple keeping track of the cards played, getting a sense of the remaining deck. High cards favor the player, low cards favor the house. They devoured books, studied probabilities, memorized charts. They practiced in their dorms, simulating casino conditions with makeshift tables and stacks of chips. Each member honed their skills, mastering the art of discreetly tracking cards, adjusting their bets, and masking their true intentions. Their training ground, not the bright lights of Vegas, but the gritty underground casinos of nearby cities. They started small, testing their system, learning to blend in, to appear like any other group of college kids blowing off steam. Mistakes were made, lessons learned. They encountered seasoned gamblers, shady characters, and the ever-present watchful eyes of casino security. They tasted both the bitterness of defeat and the exhilaration of small victories. With each outing, their confidence grew, their skills sharpened. Section 5. Vegas, baby. The city that never sleeps, where dreams are made and lost in the blink of an eye. First time at the roulette table. The anticipation was palpable, the air thick with excitement and a hint of anxiety. Las Vegas, Sin City, the mecca of gambling, the bright lights, the clanging slot machines, the intoxicating energy. It was both exhilarating and intimidating. Every corner of the casino seemed to whisper promises of fortune and tales of ruin. They were no longer playing for practice, for bragging rights. This was the real deal, with real money and real consequences. Each bet placed was a step into the unknown, a dance with fate. They started at the roulette table, a game of pure chance, to observe, to get a feel for the casino's rhythm. The spinning wheel, the bouncing ball, it was mesmerizing. They watched seasoned gamblers, their faces etched with a mixture of hope and desperation. Each expression told a story, a history of wins and losses. They studied the dealers, their every move, searching for any telltale signs, any exploitable patterns. The dealers, with their practiced hands and stoic faces, were the gatekeepers of fortune. Chips clinked as they were placed on the table, each one representing a dream, a wish for luck. The atmosphere was electric, charged with the hopes of many. The casino floor was a hive of activity, a symphony of sounds and sights. It was a world unto itself, where time seemed to stand still, and anything felt possible. Section 6. The heat is on. Casino security catches on. Their success didn't go unnoticed. Casino security, trained to spot card counters, began to take notice. Casino security. Suspicious glances turned into whispered conversations. Pit bosses lurked in the shadows, their eyes following the students' every move. The pressure mounted. The thrill of the game was now intertwined with the fear of getting caught. They had to be smarter, more cunning, more discreet. They devised signals, coded language, and strategies to throw off suspicion. Section 7. Hitting the jackpot. Big wins and bigger risks. Their winnings grew. Small stacks of chips transformed into towering piles. The rush of adrenaline, the satisfaction of outsmarting the system, was intoxicating. But with each win, the stakes rose higher, the risks more significant. They faced down intimidating pit bosses, weathered accusations of cheating, and endured the scrutiny of watchful cameras. The line between exhilaration and fear blurred. They knew they were walking a tightrope, one wrong step away from disaster. Section 8. The house always wins, or does it? The MIT students challenged that age-old adage. They weren't just any students. They were some of the brightest minds, armed with mathematical prowess and a daring spirit. They proved that with intellect, discipline, and teamwork, even the most formidable opponent could be beaten. Their strategy was meticulous, their execution flawless. Their story became a legend, whispered in hushed tones in dorm rooms and classrooms. It was a tale of audacity and brilliance, a modern-day David versus Goliath. They had achieved the impossible, but their victory came at a cost. The stakes were high, and the pressure was immense. The constant pressure, the fear of getting caught, the moral implications of their actions. It took a toll. Every win was a double-edged sword, bringing both elation and anxiety. Some walked away with their winnings, vowing never to return. They had tasted victory, but also felt the weight of their choices. Others, seduced by the thrill of the game, continued to push their luck, their lives forever changed by their brush with the world of high-stakes gambling. The allure of the casino was too strong, and the line between strategy and addiction blurred. Time and again, they returned to the tables, each roll of the dice a gamble with their future. The house may always win, but for a brief moment, these students had turned the tables, leaving an indelible mark on the world of gambling. Section 9. The Aftermath. Life after beating Vegas. The MIT card counting team's exploits became a cautionary tale, a testament to the allure and danger of beating the odds. Their story sparked debates about ethics, morality, and the very nature of luck. Casinos tightened their security, employing sophisticated surveillance techniques and countermeasures to deter future card counters. The student's story served as a reminder that even the most sophisticated systems are not foolproof, and that human ingenuity, for better or worse, can find ways to exploit even the smallest of edges.